Hi, my name is Konstantin Baum. I'm a master of wine and I scored quite a few wines on this channel and I will continue to do so. Not because I think that scores are perfect or because they are the only way to talk about quality in wine, but instead because I believe that scores are a great addition to my reviews as they represent a firm commitment. I know, however, that some of you find scores quite confusing, so I decided to show you how a score actually works by tasting two extreme examples next to each other. First, likely one of the worst wines in the world, and second, a wine that received a perfect score of 100 points from Robert Parker, so it's probably one of the best wines in the world. So let's do this. I realize that scores are a tricky topic and I've received a few comments on my last videos that I have to address. I score wines because it makes it easier for my customers and you to understand which wines I preferred in a tasting, and it helps me keep track of the wines I like best. Talk about liked. If you like this video, then please like it down here and subscribe to my channel to help me create more content. One big problem with scores is that they can be confusing, as few people really seem to understand the most widely used scoring system in the world, the 100-point scale. The 100-point scale does not start at 0, but it starts at 50 for an unacceptable wine and goes up to 100 points for a perfect wine. This is loosely based on the US high school grading system, where a score of 50 to 60 points apparently is an F. Many criticize the 100-point system for the fact that it does not start at 0, and I don't really understand the point. It's a bit like complaining why the worst grade in school is an F and not a Z. And also, most other scales don't start at 0 either. The 20-point system that is quite popular in the UK starts at 12 for faulty and unbalanced wine, and I think you also have to give at least 1 star to your review on Vivino. An average wine would be rated between 70 and 79 points, but we do not see many scores below 80 points because most wine merchants would not use a score of less than 88 points, for example, in their ads. And those average wines are mainly sold in discounts, supermarkets, and so on, where scores are not as widely used. Us wine nerds often don't realize that the majority of wine is actually sold below $10. Over here in Germany, the average price per bottle is actually less than 3 euro. That is the average, not your Burgundy Village wine. And I therefore might find a wine boring and still rate it 75 points because I think it's average. What makes scores more confusing is that even if critics use the same scale, they sometimes rate wines a little higher or a little lower on average. And then there's Luca Maroni, who seems to give 98 points to every other wine. The people at Vivino did a comparison of the scores of different critics and mapped the results against their own score. The result was that a 90-point score is roughly equal to a 4.0 score on Vivino, but also that 89 points are a little easier to get from Steven Tanzer than from Robert Parker. At the same time, it is easier to get 97 points from Robert Parker than from Antonio Galloni. What I want to show you in this video, though, is how the same product, fermented grape juice, can be terrible or amazing, outstanding, mind-changing. So let's get tasting. This should not play a role in the rating of the wine critic, but if you look at the two wines, you already see big differences. Here you see the generic Tetra Pak red wine without the name of a producer on the label or on the carton. And here you have the Napa Valley Estate Cabernet Sauvignon in a great bottle from a great, great estate with a great track record. So this already feels a lot better, a lot more high quality than that. What is kind of funny though is that this, the cheap Tetra Pak, actually has the better carbon footprint and this heavy bottle doesn't. I think producers in the future should look more at reducing the weight of their bottles in order to reduce carbon emissions. When I rate a wine, I don't break up the score into different aspects, but instead I judge the wine for its quality in its totality. But here, in order to show you how I assess a wine, I will break up the tasting into 3 different parts: what I see, what I smell, and what I taste. Easy. So just opening these wines was a very different sensation. Here we have the super flimsy and cheap Tetra Pak, and here we have a wine closed under a great natural cork, which is just beautiful, very long. But I will not try to factor that into my assessment of these two wines. you do not necessarily learn a lot about the wine just by looking at the color. The color intensity, color type, and cloudiness might help you identify the grape variety or the origin of a wine in the blind tasting, but it doesn't really tell you whether a wine is great or not. Many people, however, associate dark color with high quality. The darker the wine, the better the quality, and this is one of the reasons why the notoriously light-colored Pinot Noir is often misunderstood. In this case, the Spotswood is definitely darker colored. It's a very dense, dark purple, while the red wine from France, from the Tetra Pak, is actually a little bit lighter colored. I don't really know which grape varieties are in here, but Cabernet Sauvignon usually produces quite dark colored wines, so this is not necessarily telling me whether this is a great wine or not, and that is a bad wine or not. It just is different in color. The smell of a wine is much more important when assessing the quality. I look for cleanness, intensity, complexity, balance, and distinctiveness when smelling a wine. A wine doesn't have to score high on all factors. For example, sometimes a wine can be really, really great without being 100% clean. But for me, the most important factor is actually the balance. A wine has to be balanced in order to be great. What is actually quite interesting to see is that the wine from the Tetra Pak isn't all bad. It smells of blackberries, cherries. It's very fruit-driven, very one-dimensional though. There's not a lot of complexity there. There's not a lot of intensity there. There's not a lot of balance as well, because you only had the fruit flavor. On the other hand, the Spotswood Cabernet Sauvignon is very intense, very concentrated, but at the same time shows great complexity and great balance. It smells of cassis, blackberries, but you also have spice notes. You have a little bit of toasted bread there as well. So it's very complex. It changes all the time. There are also herbal notes coming through, like thyme. So it's quite beautiful, a very complex red wine. So the last step of the process is equally as important as the smell, and it is the taste. When I talk about taste, I talk about everything that takes place in your mouth, on your palate. I'm not talking about the aromas that go through the passage at the back of your palate to your nose. When it comes to the taste, I mainly look for richness, balance, and length. Again, wine that isn't very rich can still be amazing, depending on the other factors. So if it's very balanced and very long, it can still be a stunning wine. On the palate, these two wines are very, very different. Again, the wine from the Tetra Pak is actually very, very light. It doesn't show any richness at all. It's not very balanced because it's quite fruity, quite light. There's also not a lot of acidity. There are no tannins to talk about. So it's a very light and not very complex wine. The length is quite short, it disappears almost instantly, and tastes a little bit like a fruit juice, like a grape juice that isn't sugary. So it's quite interesting, but not necessarily something that I enjoy drinking. The Spotswood, on the other hand, is really, really amazing. It's quite concentrated, rich. The tannins are very polished. There's great freshness as well. The finish is very, very fresh and lively. It is still very young, so it's far too young to be drunk now. Unfortunately, I opened it way too early. I think you can keep this for another few decades. So it's a beautiful, beautiful, stunning wine. The length is very long. I had the last sip a minute ago, I don't know. And it's still there, very present in my mouth. So this is a complex, intense, and very balanced wine. A stunning example of a Napa Valley Cabernet Sauvignon. So let's talk about my scores for these two wines. First of all, the Tetra Pak, which was a bit of a surprise to me because I thought this would be absolutely terrible, but it wasn't. It wasn't that terrible. It's low quality, it's below average in my opinion, but it's not flawed. There are no noticeable deficiencies. It's just very bland, very boring. I wouldn't want to drink this at all, but it's not flawed. So I would score this 69 points, slightly below average, but not the worst wine I've had in my life. So let's move on to the Spotswood, which was an absolutely stunning wine. I believe that this wine is still available if you look long and hard for below $200, and that is a great price for a 100 point Robert Parker wine. Would I give this 100 points? Not quite. I think this is a stunning wine, a beautiful wine with lots of complexity, but I think there's just a little bit more that this wine could give to get to 100 points. I'm very critical with wines. I do like to give 100 point scores, but only to the very, very best of the best. And I would score this 97 points. So it's a beautiful, outstanding wine. Definitely worth seeking out, but it's not quite perfect. So I hope you liked this video. If you liked it, then please like it down here. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already. We are moving ahead and getting bigger and bigger, which is great. So thank you all for that. My question of the day is, which is the best wine you have ever tasted? Could be 100 point wines, could be less than 100 points. I don't care. Just comment down below. I'm going to put the Tetra Pak to the side and I'm going to drink the Spotswood tonight. I hope I see you guys again soon. Until then, stay thirsty.